station that's on your side. This is News 12, first at 4.
Good afternoon. We're starting to see a little bit of relief from the rain. Seems to be clearing up just in time for Friday night football under the lights. And Payne College kicking off the fall semester today with their convocation, welcoming a new class of freshmen. All this comes as the school is bouncing back from some hard times. Payne was able to recover after almost losing accreditation. They say they're coming back with more things to offer students. Maria Sellers reports on how Augusta's HBCU is handling the challenge.
Well, students have returned and classes have started back here at Payne College, and the president says there is a lot of new things in store here for students this year. One major topic of conversation, resilience. At convocation this morning, students heard from the president of the college, who highlighted increased enrollment, increasing retention rates, and recruiting students. The president says the college has faced many challenges in the past, and these are all goals they hope to accomplish this year.
And we have recruiters who go out across the CSRA, across Georgia, and other parts of the country, recruiting students, telling the story about Payne College, and letting people know that they can get there from here.
And coming up tonight on News 12 at 6 o'clock, we'll have a closer look at this ceremony and hear more about what's new for students this year. Reporting in Augusta, Maria Sellers, On Your Side.
And congratulations to the folks over at Payne College on a new semester there. We are clearing up in time just for Friday night football. So, Anthony, we need the sunshine to work in a little more before kickoff comes in just a few hours.
Yeah, definitely. We do have 10 minutes, Richard.
Anthony, thank you. A judge set to take up several motions filed in the Alec Murdaugh case on Monday. The Attorney General's office did not elaborate on which motions might be considered, but the defense filed a subpoena against the state investigators to bring copies of warrants and other evidence to court that day. Murdaugh's attorneys have accused the state of withholding evidence and of leaking information on the murders of Murdaugh's wife and son. We're learning new details about why the FBI searched Donald Trump's Florida home. The Justice Department finally filing a redacted version of that affidavit that led to the search warrant. Parts of the document, in fact, almost half of it, blacked out today. According to legal documents already made public, federal agents are investigating potential violations of federal laws.
It seems unlikely that any judge would have issued a warrant for a former president's home if it hadn't been a very strong case.
Meanwhile, another federal court judge has given the former president's legal team until the end of today to explain in more detail why he's requesting a special master to be appointed to review the documents seized from Mar-a-Lago. A controversial billboard campaign in San Francisco and Los Angeles discouraging Californians from moving to Texas, and it's facing some heavy backlash. The message behind the billboard is adding to the already existing rivalry between the two states. The billboard targets gun violence in Texas, but it's not clear who's behind this ad campaign. Texas Governor Greg Abbott and California's Governor Gavin Newsom are polar opposites on the political spectrum. Census data on average shows more than 68,000 Californians move to Texas every year.
Get to look at it often. I don't think it's in particularly good taste.
I totally agree with it 100%. You know, so many people are leaving here and going to Texas anyway. It's like, don't go there. That is why.
California supporters point out with their population of 39 million, that's less than 1% of people moving to Texas. College students heading back to campus this fall will hear familiar guidance about COVID and some new warnings about monkeypox. The CDC has recorded nearly 17,000 monkeypox cases nationwide. New York with the most out of any other state. Schools in New York ramping up cleaning and disinfecting to help stop the spread there.
Our team has practiced this, we're ready for this, and this is what we do every day. The good news is that monkeypox is not like COVID in that it is not as easily spread.
Experts still say the risk in colleges is low, but something colleges need to be on the lookout for. The American College Health Association has hosted webinars and events on preparing for monkeypox and COVID. The veterans of foreign wars in South Carolina collecting supplies to help Kentucky flood victims. At the beginning of August, the eastern part of the state saw devastating floods that left dozens dead and hundreds without homes, and they're still struggling to recover. They're asking for bottled water, canned food, cleaning supplies, the VFW accepting donations through the 11th of September. Happening right now, Savannah Riverside hosting a job fair. It's going on at USC Aiken's Activity Center until 7 this evening. They're looking for engineers, software development, and more. You can register ahead on their website. There's also an upcoming job fair with Augusta Transit. That information is on our website as well. Well, after being hit by vandals recently, the McBean splash pad is finally back open again, and the weather's still warm enough. It comes after completing some repairs and making some site improvements. That location opened back in July, and just a week later, they had to shut it down after someone damaged the control units that control the water turning on and off. Splash pad has to have water, Anthony.
Absolutely. Hey, it's still definitely going to be warm, and it's going to be muggy as we go through the next couple of days. For tonight, we are tracking a few scattered showers and storms. We'll let you know if that affects Friday Night Football plans coming up next.
Also ahead, first and four, NASA just days away now from starting a brand new journey to the moon. We take a look at the giant rocket set to launch on Monday.
Diamond Tech Cooling, your local Reed Pro partner.
$280 million returned to the Small Business Administration today. That's money illegally obtained through COVID relief funds. As Natalie Brand reports, the Secret Service has been investigating 30 months of pandemic fraud.
The Secret Service returned $286 million in stolen government funds to the Small Business Administration Friday as part of its ongoing investigations into pandemic fraud. In this case, phony applications for economic injury disaster loans known as EIDL.
The majority of the accounts had been established using synthetic identities, stolen personal identifiable information, or the utilization of willing and unwilling money mules.
Investigators say the conspirators used the online bank Green Dot to move the funds. While that money is now back in the right hands, the perpetrators connected to more than 15,000 fake accounts are still at large.
The investigation continues, and we fully anticipate identifying suspects in the case.
EIDL loan fraud has affected innocent victims during the pandemic, like this California man who learned his name and identity were stolen to snag federal relief.
I had applied for a small business loan for $5,000 to open up my own deli in Texas. I can barely make peanut butter sandwiches, let alone open a deli.
This month, President Biden signed into law two bipartisan bills extending the statute of limitations for COVID relief fraud enforcement to 10 years.
You can't hide. We're going to find you. We're going to make you pay back what you stole and hold you accountable under the law.
The Secret Service says that extension will afford the agency the extra time it needs to track down the criminals. Natalie Brent, CBS News, Washington.
And the Secret Service says it's possible foreign agents were involved in all this. The agency says it's launched more than 3,800 pandemic-related fraud investigations since back in 2020, and they've seized more than $1.4 billion. A father and son rescued yesterday after their boat sank off the coast of Boston. Crews responded to Boston Harbor around 6:30 in the evening after getting that 911 call. The father wearing a life vest while his son was clinging to a life buoy and a cooler to stay afloat. It took rescuers about 8 minutes to reach that 78-year-old man and his son. They were stranded in that water for about 15 minutes near an island, just about 8 miles from the port of Boston. Must have seemed like forever until help arrived. Listen up, parents. Huffy Corporation announcing it's recalling several Blue's Clues toys. The problem? Fall and injury hazards. The Consumer Product Safety Commission says the recall involves Blue's Clues foot-to-floor, ride-on toys. The company got reports of children falling forward while they're riding this toy. The company says to put it away and contact them for further instructions, but don't keep using it. Wednesday marks 25 years since Princess Diana's death. Diana was in a car with her boyfriend, Dodi Fayed, in Paris as photographers chased them in a high-speed chase August 31st, 1997. The driver reportedly drunk and crashed into a tunnel near the Seine River. Diana was only 36 years old at the time. She married Prince Charles, the heir to the British throne, back in 1981, a wedding watched around the world. But after their divorce, she continued her charity work and took care of her sons, Princes William and Harry. The pause on student loan payments was extended Wednesday, and President Biden canceling $10,000 in debt for borrowers making $125,000 a year or less. In this Watching Your Wallet, consumer investigator Rachel DePompa looks at what your next step should be if you have student loans.
This extension gives borrowers a little bit more time to get organized and figure out the future of their student loans. There are a lot of moving parts with different loan forgiveness programs and different repayment options out there. And Robert Farrington, the CEO of the College Investor, says about half of all student loan borrowers have also seen their loan servicer change over the last 2 years.
This extra extension will allow borrowers to get organized, figure out who owns their loans these days, where they should be making their payments, and ensuring that they have enough time to prepare for when payments do restart.
Farrington says go to your loan servicer's website, or if you don't know your loan servicer's website, go to studentaid.gov and enter your information.
Hey, maybe you've moved. Maybe you have a new email address, maybe a new phone number. Make sure that contact information is updated so that when payments do resume, you're ready to go.
It's been more than 2 years since you've paid these loans. Something is bound to have changed, so check in. Also, create a budget now to prepare for when those loans do start back up again. And Farrington says, if you're able to, start setting aside a little bit of money each month to make a future payment. With this Watching Your Wallet, I'm Rachel DePompa.
We have this breaking news just coming into our newsroom. A judge denying former Commissioner Sammy Sias' request for an acquittal. Sias has been federally charged with lying to investigators and destroying public documents. The former Augusta Commissioner was recently found guilty in a 4-day trial in federal court.
Well, we continue on through this evening.
With school getting back in session, officials are working to make sure things are safe on campus. In Charlotte, they found 30 guns in schools last year. Ahead of this school year, law enforcement wants to continue bridging the gap in the community, so they're holding an event this weekend to help stop the violence, calling it a family reunion as a way to bring the whole community together.
Come and see love firsthand. Come and see families. Come and see law enforcement. And then stereotype us that if this picnic goes, there will always be law enforcement and the community together. And we're not out here to enforce the law. We're just out here to meet our family.
Again, this reunion is going on in the Charlotte community as they begin their new school year. A Georgia school district introducing a new bullying reporting system to combat the rising number of incidents at school. It's called the Anonymous Alerts Anti-Bullying and Safety App, and it lets students report bullying, crime, negativity seen by students during the school hours straight from their smartphones. School leaders say keeping students anonymous will give them a much easier process to report the things they see and experience every day.
I think that's probably what was missing before. Things weren't being said because they didn't feel comfortable. They would later have a snitch to go out and get the word back. But I think now that having this way to report something and still keep their hands out of it, you know, I think it'll help us a lot.
The National Center for Educational Statistics reports one in every five students is bullied in school. There's a special team of workers in Spartanburg keeping the